Debaditya, to take back to your vision of the university, right. Then, okay, so if this is something that we are fighting against, what is it that we are fighting for?
Right.
And in the university, I'm thought you say that there is a fault that people make.
Right.
Certain people who are also critical of these policies,
right.
Who are probably on our side or at least on your side, they will fall into what you call a kind of liberal nostalgia for the welfare state.
Right.
And you say that is not. That is not the formula that you are suggesting. So what is your problem with this, and B, what is it that you are suggesting? What is your vision that you are suggesting in the book?
This huge debate, but I will just give you the basic outlines of what I'm suggesting, because in most cases, in trying to fight back against this neoliberal onslaught, what we seem to champion is a welfare state model, right? So where the state is only going to act as a regulator of the market, right? So where public funding has to stay there, but the state will nonetheless act as a regulator for channelizing private capital in specific fields. Now, what we forget through all of this is that the liberal university has not been an innocent space. The liberal university, right, so despite its tokenistic espousal of social justice, right, so has historically excluded specific castes. It has historically excluded women. It has historically excluded the working classes, right? So, and the history of the university is not a history of untempered academic freedom. It's not a history that we can just exhilarate over, right? So the history of the university is a history which is actually fraught with all kinds of class, caste, gender solidarities. And therefore, in privileging the liberal university over the neoliberal university, we are possibly being unattentive to the histories of the liberal university. What I suggest is that the university must become the site of its own critique. Okay. It is time for us to realize, right, that the university has not been this wonderfully collegial space, right, so of academic emancipation or intellectual emancipation, right? So therefore, just privileging autonomy and academic intellectual autonomy over an engagement with questions of social justice, sexual justice, right? So cannot work, right? So the model of disinterested academic labor or autonomy also has to be questioned. And the university itself can become the site for that questioning.
And interestingly, you cite Rabindranath Tagore as a kind of predecessor who was thinking along these lines.
Exactly. Absolutely. Because Rabindranath, towards the end of his life, had said that I have very little hope out of Shantiniketan, out of Bishwabharati, but I actually look forward to Sriniketan. So Rabindranath had, in several of his letters, actually spoken of the fact that the university must pay attention to the economic interests of the nation, lest the economic interests of the nation prescribe a role for the university. Okay. Right? So the university must be or must enter into a relationship with its own outsides. Okay. Right? So until the time the university establishes a relationship with its own outsides, and which is why Rabindranath sets up an Institute of Rural Reconstruction at Sriniketan alongside a Bishwabharati in Shantiniketan. Right? So until and unless the university enters into a dialogue with its outside, right, so the university is going to be again kind of sucked into its own self-image.
Debaditya, a personal question: are you a first generation academic in higher education, like or?
Yes, in my family, yes.
So I sort of got that sense from reading your preface, where you say, and I'm quoting you here: "Through my childhood years, I responded to the interlocutors of ambition by saying that I want to become an educationist. When queried why, I self-assuredly said, without the faintest clue of what it meant, that I want to better the state of education in the country." Now, for some inexplicable reason, I hate that word, educationist. Perhaps because I know there is none by that name, I dedicate this book to all who did not want to become educationists.
Right.
I think these are really beautiful lines and moving lines for an academic book. I would expect this in a memoir or some other form. But why is it that, like, could you take us through some of the personal troubles that you've had while you have arrived at these very, very clear rational arguments that you just presented to me and for our viewers. But the kind of personal struggle of a first generation academic when he or she has to wait through this now neoliberal university and before you the liberal university.
Right. First of all, I think as a Hindu Brahmin man, right, so whether or not, right, so we had money enough to study in private universities, we had social capital, right, so that was there, right, so I am born into a default privilege by virtue of my religion and my caste and my gender. Right, so that is something that we have to go with. Right, so but nonetheless, of course, as you say, right, so first generation academic is an interesting word. Right, so it's an interesting coinage. Yes, indeed. Right, and which is why, right, of course, through my schooling, right, so I of course wanted to get into humanities, or let's say I wanted to pursue literature. Right, so right even before my 10th. Right, so now of course that was also the time of a massive, let's say, state-sponsored advertisement of engineering and technological sciences, right? So that was the time when this shift was actually happening. So I'm a product of the 90s as such, right? And that was when the, as I told you,
I mean,
right,
your personal history sort of completely correlates and coincides with the history of policy, a change in policy framework.
Yes. So that was the time, right? So when people within the family, people within the extended family, my parents would constantly try and force me into engineering or the science disciplines because these were the more paying disciplines. Right? So because these are disciplines which one can evidently make careers out of. And it was believed that literature and social sciences wasn't even a phenomenon at that point of time. Right, so and particularly in a place like Bengal, right, so social sciences weren't even considered to be, history for that matter, in the 90s, right, so in middle-class Bengali families, right, so wasn't even considered an option worth thinking about, right. So here is a person wanting to enter into humanities was in itself anathema, right, so therefore there was there was a tremendous amount of not just mental violence, right, so, but also a lot of physical violence that one has to, and I think this is part of the childhood memories of a lot of us who have finally ended up in humanities, right, so we were beaten up into taking up, so I was finally forced into taking up a science education for my 12th, but I finally scraped through, right, so, but of course because I scraped through, they thought that this man can still go ahead and do a maths honours or a science honours or an engineering course. I ended up at presidency, right, so I did not, my certificates and everything were taken away, right, so that's a long story, right, so, but the long story cut short, I think finally when I entered into an English honours program, and for the longest time even we were battling out the kind of cuts and slashes in funding, and of course the state of crisis that we humanities people constantly cry about even now, though I think there's more that we need to do than just crying about it, right, so given the reality of it, right, so we went through that entire period of near clinical depression, and we would have to kind of engage in family conversations where people would say that that's the mistake that you've committed, right? So you should have just gone into a management course, you should have just gone into an engineering course, right? So you, because of your utterly misplaced idea of education, right, so have landed up in this quandary, right? So that's largely the kind of personal history that one speaks out of. But I think that last bit of an anecdote.
Why do you not call yourself an educationist? I mean, you are an educationist, I may say, in the sense that you have entered the education.
Right, right.
You are teaching students.
Right, right.
At least in three states of India, you've already done that.
Right.
So, and yet you don't want to recognize yourself with that.
Right. I think the word educationist comes with a certain kind of assumption of moral authority over education, which is something that I hate. Right, so because the way in which the education sector has shaped up in India, that moral authority can now be claimed by no one. Right, so, and I think I would rather like to imagine myself as a student and a teacher rather than an educationist who claims to be morally pronouncing on policy, who claims to be morally pronouncing on education. So there's a very, very personal kind of revulsion that I have developed over the word, around that word, and I would rather want to look at myself, and I think most people who have written for these volumes, and we have some wonderful people who have devoted their entire careers to thinking about their higher education, to thinking about and working around education and educational policy, right, so and I think most of them would like to rather call themselves students and teachers as much as I would. So I think it's out of very deep political convictions, right, so that these volumes have emerged, right, so, and more than the academic, I think it's a political act, right? So it's a political work that we have tried putting together through these two volumes.
Thanks very much for putting them together, and not just to you, but also to the other contributors.
Yeah.
Hopefully we can probably follow up in some of these conversations with some of the contributors to this volume.
Absolutely.
I look forward to that. Thanks very, very much for your time.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for getting me over. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for watching. Please make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel to make sure so that you can hear some of these interviews. And please make sure that you check out some of our website, www.indianculturalforum.in, so that you can actually look up some of these debates that we've been engaging in for quite some time now. Thanks for watching.